so as we get ready to get started, I wanted to pass, we have two things for us to do between now and March 13th. We have a solid waste bill, we have a fish and wildlife bill, we're originating, we're also going to see 267, the RES bill that's in finance, it's going to get voted out and comes back to us. So I'm just, we're going to have to be somewhat nimble. There's a Senate housing bill that includes provisions in our first couple sections related to planning. And so whether we're talking Act 250 or talking the municipal planning things, we need to deal with both. That's a matter of its title. And we'll need to be able to respond to that in a timely way, but that doesn't cross over. And food residuals are under discussion in the Ag Committee in terms of being a feedstock for compost and chicken feed in another way to make it. So we're going to need to be able to respond to that. So there's, we'll have a lot to cover, a lot of ground to cover.
This week.
We're going to have to be.
Before March 13th, he said.
Before March 13th.
Okay. Yes. So we have the balance of this week, and we have the full week when we get back from town.
Okay.
So, meanwhile, to get us ready on the solid waste bill, there's a short article here on extended use and responsibility, which we've talked about a little bit. Give people copies if you read this ahead of time, the conversations that we're going to have on EPR, extended use and responsibility, will be warning.
Thank you.
Okay. There's also, it's just so people know, an overview of the procedure amendment on the Constitution. We have Prop 9 added outright to the Clean Air and Water Constitution. We're not going to take that up until really in depth, until after crossover, because double check this with the Senate Secretary, but constitutional amendments aren't subject to our crossover deadline. So, but I don't want to wait much longer than crossover deadline, because should we pick it up, move it, pass it, in the House enough time to dig in and look. So honestly, from what I've been reading, it will be an interesting conversation to figure out what do we gain for ourselves by having a provision like that in the Constitution.
Well,
Senator Bright, did this Scott Cassell, did he testify before this committee?
He came this fall to speak at the St. James College School.
Okay.
He
was on, I thought, yeah.
One of his associates spoke instead.
Oh, okay, that's right. Reference Scott, thank you.
And you can name it. So, Senator Bright, before we move on on the whole constitutional thing, I guess my interest in it is I signed on because I believe in the premise of it, but how do we protect individuals' property rights is going to be a major concern for me as we move forward.
Yeah, Article 1, Chapter 1, rights of life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, and property. So Vermont started out with property right front and center, and how we balance that off. I mean, honestly, I think it would be pretty interesting to figure out how we make the private property rights while also affirming explicitly for ourselves that we believe in having a female environment, mm-hmm. especially given what's been going on at the federal level, where they're reversing things that have been in effect for most of our lifetime, which I didn't think any of us would see, but it's happening. Mm-hmm. It's conceivable this administration will continue for another 4+ years.
Don't worry, humanity's only got a couple more generations, right, Brian?
There could be further erosions that we might want to put ourselves in a better position to respond to. So that's it for air traffic control. So we really have two major bills on our own, two or three other bills that we're going to see, and maybe think paddling full steam ahead from here to March 13th. Okay. With that, I can invite Melissa Bailey. Ms. Bailey to join us at the table.
Are you going to cry, or should we move to tissues?
Hopefully I won't be brought to tears. Depends on your response.
And for the committee, so again, this is, because we're going to see two studies, I didn't want to have
You might see two studies. There are now discussions as to whether or not it needs to come back here.
Oh, well,
it was an agreement. We're now asking if the rules is that they're going to
by rule, it will not need to go to finance, but
thank you.
Shared.
Was there a witness?
My mother was there. Okay. So, not to be ready to respond if you just keep going when it comes back. So, with that, good morning.
Good morning. I'm Melissa Bailey with Vermont Public Power Supply Authority. Thank you to the committee for having me in. And
that is a beautiful photograph, by the way. Yeah, I'm just curious. It's really stunning.
I believe that that one is Morrisville, the Cadiz Falls Hydro.
Okay. Really, really nice.
Yeah, pretty dramatic.
Thank you. At the end of the
test. So we'd want to talk about the importance of community hydro to the VEPSA members, and that will come out in my testimony. As the committee is aware, I'm here representing 11 municipal electric utilities in Vermont that represent roughly 6% of Vermont's aggregate load. VEPSA offers a variety of services to these municipals. I think the committee is aware. Those are listed on the third slide. Specifically power supply rates and planning and financial services, as well as legislative and regulatory support for these, the member utilities. And jumping into our overarching position on Vermont's energy and climate policy, as this committee has heard, VEPSA is supportive of meeting state energy and climate goals in the most cost-effective manner. The term cost-effective does not mean unwilling to incur costs, and sometimes I think it gets misconstrued that way, but really VEPSA's core position is that we should be efficient with scarce resources, ratepayer resources, and taxpayer resources, and target those where we'll get the most bang for our buck in terms of making progress on energy and climate issues. And we strongly believe that a comprehensive strategy across all energy sectors is needed. There has been a lot of focus, as we've talked about, on the electric sector. And we think that a broader policy covering all sectors is really going to best serve the state. As community-owned nonprofit entities beholden to our member customers, cost-effectiveness and equity are both paramount to VEPSA members, and with any kind of policy change, we're cognizant of who's benefiting and bearing the costs of those policy decisions. We have desire to minimize cost shifting and really do any shifting among ratepayers in a mindful way, in a deliberate way, and not have that be a byproduct of an unwanted byproduct of policies. And since this bill specifically, I think as drafted, would promote more solar development, I think we do have some concerns around whether unregulated private entities will maximize the public benefit and achieve the most for climate and energy goals. So, and the final point I want to highlight in my testimony is VEPSA's members have experienced to some extent, a disconnect in state energy policies, and that would be the policies around, when we get into talking about the hydro units, maintaining water quality and protecting biotic life, and our goals to increase renewable energy, and specifically in-state renewable generation. And so to the extent practical, we'd like to see policies that are more in cohesion as we move towards potentially 100% renewable future. So moving specifically on to the bill, VEPSA is supportive of increasing renewability in the electric sector. We're supportive of 100% renewable energy standard requirement, the so-called Tier 1 requirement. We clearly see value there as conversations around increasing reliance on the electric sector as a larger portion of our overall energy use. It's important that be drawing from clean energy, so we're supportive of that.
I just want to make sure, we've been in the thick of this.
Yes.
Not everybody has.
Right.
So I don't know if it's worth saying just a few words of what's happening.
Yeah.
Because we don't have a bill in front of us. I'm sorry to do that.
No.
Yeah.
So, right.
You don't have the bill. Oh.
Right.
I'll we get 60,000 feet on it, we make sure to see all of it and working in detail. But so the 267 says for tier one, where we currently have a goal of moving from 55 to 75 by 2032, that will pick up the pace and make all energy on the grid renewable by 2030. So tier one basically shortens it back 2 years and goes, so 75 is the endpoint, it's 100%. That really goes hand in glove with our stuff like beneficial electrification. It's really only beneficial if the power that's here, the fossil fuel you're displaced is displaced by clean electricity. So a coal power plant driving power to your EV. the second major piece in that bill is to take tier two, which says it's a carve out in that 100% or 75%, but you need to do local renewable generation. It's 5 megawatts or less distributed, and has to be sited in Vermont. And it says 10% of the, from the current law, 10% of the 75% must be of that nature. The proposal is that going forward, if it's 100%, it would also be 20% of that 100%. And the question is, if you're doubling the amount of in-state generation, what are the engineering and financial impacts of that kind of shift in mandatory purchase of power supply and in-state?
Well, I would question the value of in-state. I mean, what? Why is in-state more valuable than out-of-state if somebody else has a renewable resource that's easy to pipe here? And I think one is as valuable as the other.
I don't want to speak. I mean, I think that apart from what's come up in finance, that's where the economic development piece is a component of this. I think people believe if I'm just answering, as best I can, the question and some of the concerns. The other thing I just want to mention, if you want to say a few words about how this would connect us or disconnect us with Hydro-Québec a little bit, because in part, that's one of the goals of this.
Right, so there's another provision in the bill which says that as we go forward, that we, well, I think it's actually any expansion of renewable energy in the future will not rely on a large-scale existing hydro. So, I don't remember the precise way it's formed, and you've been in the middle of it, but it ends up removing Hydro-Québec as one of the sources, I think, for fulfilling the growth to 100% renewable.
And then part of that, I guess, I was in a conversation locally yesterday. It was having to do with if Hydro-Québec continues to expand, what is that impact? I think a combination of not only on a negative impact on the environment, but also I believe there's concern about indigenous peoples up there as it relates to the expansion. So those are just some of the themes that have come up in finance.
Right, but also Hydro-Québec is invested in large scale wind development in places where there's not many people. And so there's the question is it better?
See, that has not come up.
Is it better to, if they can get the power here cheaper, in my mind, it's better that they're putting it in a big flat place with no people than blowing off the top of another mountain. And so my concern with this in-state stuff is the environmental impact we have in this state. And there's a whole bunch of people that don't think blowing the top off a mountain and putting industrial wind on it has, a negative environmental impact, but I believe it does.
And I can never foresee us putting another hydro facility in the state of Vermont.
No, and that's it. Even our small hydros that, to me, make perfect sense to be generating power, you can't, it's not economically feasible to put small hydro in, because by the time you've been through all your permitting and engineering and regulation, you've spent more money than they can ever pay you back. So I'm just saying, I don't necessarily agree with the economic argument about jobs, because like Lowell, all the money, the profit that's created goes, Gas Metro is the parent company. So, I mean, yes, they pay a lot of employees here in the state, but still the overall profits go back to a multinational company.
Do you happen to know if the wind on the Gaspé Peninsula, is that Hydro-Québec? Does anybody know that?
I'm not sure which one is theirs, but I know they've got a big one up there somewhere.
So, right, I mean, this is a good example of that it's a very interconnected system. So when we get adjusting in one place, there are intended and unintended consequences that will, and we'll, so thank you everyone for surfacing these things. We'll have to dig into it before we would fill up, but I think there's, to add one more complexity to it, someone alleged to me, I don't know if it's accurate or not, we'll have to get testimony, that part of HQ's strategy is to sell clean renewable energy to the states. There's a rent value associated with it, but they're backfilling their own demand with fossil fuel power generation because they're exporting enough hydro that they need power in their own region to fulfill their own needs. So that would be, I don't think we would want to have the bulk pull over our eyes on that word in case. We just need to know.
Yeah, thanks.
Right. So thank you for offering this very stimulating point. And thanks actually for flagging it. That's what's operating in the background.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, so these comments will be on the bill as drafted, which I think has been characterized. I see three components. One, moving us towards a 100% renewable energy in the electric sector requirement by, I believe, 2030, increasing the distributed generation in-state requirement to 20%, and then this limit on Hydro-Quebec, on the amount of Hydro-Quebec power that any utility could hold in its portfolio. So again, BEPS is supportive of the 100% RES. I think the testimony in the building has been fairly consistent on that. I have not heard a lot of opposition to that provision.
Can you explain how that's not more, I mean, why that's cost, you know, affordable, basically?
Which, I'm sorry, would you?
100.
The 101, getting there sooner, which seems like great news. I just wondering how it is that everyone's comfortable picking up the pace that.
Sure. And I think it does get to your point about there's a lot of interconnection in the electric sector around the region, and there is potentially some benefit to getting there first. I guess what I would say is existing resources, you know, all renewable generation essentially comes with the renewable energy credit that is available to be bought and sold separate from the generation. And there is an adequate supply around the region of renewable generation, enough to keep those prices fairly low. I can't be specific on prices, but in the single digits of dollars for a existing, you know, REC. So because of the hydro that exists in Maine and other parts of the region, you can purchase those at a fairly low cost. There absolutely will be a cost to going from 75% to 100%, but it's not, when you're looking at the trade-offs, it doesn't seem to be an palatable cost from our perspective. And it is, again, if every state in New England, I mean, I've tried to run through these scenarios in my brain, if every state in New England went to 100% renewable standard, then those RECs would be in shortage and that would drive up costs. There is something to be said if Vermont is the first one to implement. I believe other states are either committed or contemplating this commitment to 100% renewable, but being a little bit ahead essentially gets you some benefit there. And we do have a lot of existing renewable resources, and I think that sometimes gets lost in the conversation about how much new resources to promote. There is a lot already in the ground, specifically around hydro. So doubling tier two, I think you've heard testimony from several other parties. There is a good deal of angst around the cost impact of simply doubling tier two as currently structured. There will be costs. Those are expensive resources to build. There's some concern that they're more expensive than the value they deliver to ratepayers, so kind of an above market added cost. There are siting and grid concerns as well, which I think have been highlighted in testimony, but you know, VELCO, the statewide transmission entity, has, I think, put those costs of enabling the transmission grid to absorb or accommodate this level of distributed generation in the hundreds of millions of dollars. And I believe the department put the power supply costs of procuring in-state renewable resources in the tens of millions of dollars.
How much?
Tens of millions. I think it was 15 to 55 million.
They had quite a range depending on where it was, the selection of where it located.
Exactly, the location matters, and there is, I think, some concern that this, we're talking about 1,000 to 1,200 megawatts of solar would be needed to meet this, and there is some concern that we might simply run out of sites and actually not be able to build projects, in which case folks will remember that under the Renewable Energy Standard, the fallback is if you can't procure the resource, you pay the ACP, which is over $60 a megawatt hour and growing. And so I think there were some assumptions about, in that wide range of cost estimates, about utilities needing to essentially pay the penalty rather than being able to build due to the grid constraints and the locational siting constraints. So in terms of testimony, ongoing conversations have been going on. I think you've heard from a lot of utilities that they're asking for some sort of flexibility if this Tier 2 requirement does get increased. To Senator Rogers' point, some utilities are asking for acknowledgement of regional resources. The flexibility that VEPSA thinks would be most valuable is placing added value on existing hydro resources that are in the state, our community-owned hydros. And valuing those as tier two resources would help keep them economically viable and keep in-state generation running. So as we're looking to increase the amount of generation that we actually have located in Vermont, our position is that we should do everything we can to maintain what's already been built, the investments that customers have already made in renewable energy, as well as, so not instead of promoting new resources, but as a complement to promoting new resources.
Isn't there, just thinking outside the box here for a second, if we continue to move just towards solar, we've got a little bit of wind, there has to be some base load. And so without hydro, Quebec, I know we've got a lot of small generators, but I guess I don't understand right now, unless there's huge leaps in storage technology, then how do we provide base load with solar and wind?
It's a really good question, and I think we need to. It's the complexities of the REC market, essentially. So we, and I will show our power supply chart, but we're able to purchase baseload power, and that may or may not be renewable. I mean, we do have some renewable resources in Rygate, and HQ does act as a baseload resource. But the way that renewable energy standards, or RPSs, in the rest of the states are structured, you can purchase your power, and then you can purchase your renewability elsewhere.
So if you whether sprinkle a little pixie dust on a gas generator, it becomes renewable.
Exactly. Whether it's ideal or not, that is the regional structure that we have. So,
but wouldn't getting rid of HQ, or not qualifying it as renewable anymore, wouldn't that create a major hurdle because of the amount of energy that we get? Wouldn't utilities have to spend a bunch more on RECs?
Yes, absolutely. If HQ were not qualified as renewable, there would be a big cost pressure for the tier one.
It would be passed on to ratepayers. Okay,
absolutely. And I think that was a deliberate decision that the legislature made in setting the 75% current RES target. Was we're going to set a more aggressive renewable target than any other state in the region, and we're going to allow large hydro to qualify, which none of the other states, they all set their targets lower, 20 or 30%, and didn't allow HQ to qualify. So, and my understanding in this bill is that it wouldn't change, it wouldn't exclude HQ from tier one compliance or eligibility, it would limit that to 35%. We could use 35% of our tier one compliance could come from Hydro-Quebec. But yes, to the extent we can't rely on Hydro-Quebec, there will be cost pressures from other resources that would need to fill that need.
So, remember the pricing scheme for RECs. Tier one is roughly $1 per megawatt hour, and tier two, that we associate with something like solar, is, I can't remember, 30, 40, 60?
I think in the most recent energy report that the department put forward, it was in the $35 to $40 range, and currently, and again, that's capped at the ACP of 60, and the concern is, that if we're not able to build, that's going to increase. That's the current, those are the current, essentially, values of tier two. Again, we're moving on to some considerations. that we looked at when we were in the context of this bill. Again, these have been touched on. The support, the goals of the bill, you know, one, getting to 100% renewable energy clearly does have some carbon reduction benefit, but the doubling of Tier 2 seems mainly targeted at supporting local in-state jobs rather than carbon reduction. And I say that because, as we've discussed, the electric sector is currently 2% of our carbon emissions. So there's 98% of our carbon emissions are coming from elsewhere. So if the primary goal were emissions reductions, we would probably, that would implicate a different strategy.
That's a really good point.
2% of all purchases are, or 2% base load?
So from ANR data, 2% of our carbon emissions across, holistically, across the transportation sector, manufacturing, electric sector. The electric sector is only 2% of those.
Yeah, thank you. We saw a very interesting chart in the, way back in the first week where it showed the assessment by fuel type. Electricity stay at the highest, and then if you looked at emissions per fuel type, they also have the lowest, you know, emissions associated with it. So electricity is out front of the other fuel types.
Exactly, it's highly taxed, if you call it a tax, the surcharges we put on electricity, while also being fairly clean. And so our concern there, of course, is that household energy costs, the electric bill is a significant component of those. And of course, we're keeping in mind that increasing costs in the electric sector make it harder for customers, for homeowners to electrify either their vehicle or their heating source. So it's running in cross purposes to other state policies and goals. And so I think this is this bill opens the conversation about what is the value of in-state generation, what is the appropriate amount of generation to have in-state versus import from other regions or other states, or potentially our neighbors to the north. Is 10% the right amount? Is 20% the right amount? And I would point out also, I think we received testimony from the Department of Public Service that there's much more in-state generation than what counts under Tier 2. I just want to make that really clear that Tier 2 is a very small subset of our in-state generation. We're talking about excluding the wind projects. We're talking about excluding any project that's over 5 megawatts, and also the new date in statute that is July 1st, 2015. So even our standard offer projects that were procured to increase renewable generation in the state don't technically count as new, and they don't count towards Tier 2 compliance. So we do have a lot more in the ground than we're counting.
And all new net metering by default goes into Tier 2.
New net metering, so post 2017, if the customer elects to transfer the REC to the utility, which they're compensated, so I won't say give the REC, but if they transfer the REC, they're compensated for that, and the utility must retire the REC. If the customer elects to retain the REC, they can sell it, they can do whatever they want with it. So not all new net metering, but the net metering that the utilities receive, which is the vast majority of new net metering, that automatically goes towards Tier 2.
Okay. Are many people opting out? I don't know, businesses might say they want to be able to make the claim.
Exactly.
So they retain the rest as a cost, an acceptable cost to them. Are you seeing much of that, or are most people just letting it flow through to the utility?
I would say 90%+ transfer to the utility because of the differential in compensation. Yeah. They get more revenue for their kilowatt hours.
Ms. Bailey, would you just mention, so the cost pressure in the electric sector will undermine state climate goals. Do we know for sure that this is going to increase electric costs, and over what kind of period would it increase electric costs? Because I remember in finance we talked a little bit about, you know, we're talking, there's some unpredictability there.
Tier 2 will absolutely increase. Yeah. I mean, you're talking about
2%. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, that's the emissions. I mean, there have been different rate increase numbers that you've seen, you know, in the 5 to 10% rate increase. There are a lot of variables, but it will absolutely increase costs in the electric sector, because buying in-state generation costs currently $30 or $40 more a megawatt hour than non.
So we know how much it'll cost, I mean, what we're looking at.
For overall state costs?
This cost pressure in the electric sector will undermine state climate goals. I'm not quite there in agreeing with you. I really don't know if that will happen. I think in part it depends on what those electric costs actually look like, and and whether or not it'll make that kind of an impact, such a negative impact.
And I have not, I think it's additive, right? I think that our concern is that we have a lot of cost pressures in the electric sector. We've kind of had this conversation in the energy efficiency utility realm as well. Whether a 2% rate increase or a 5% rate increase, I mean, to your question, where is that tipping point where it makes it uneconomic to go to an electric vehicle or a heat pump? I think for electric vehicles, the operating costs, it's a fairly compelling difference between an electric vehicle operations versus a gas-powered vehicle. So I think there's potentially more room for increasing rates. I did recently see the testimony of the department comparing heat pump deployments in WEC's territory and GMP's territory, and that's maybe a 5 to 8% rate difference, and it actually makes it uneconomic to put in a heat pump. And I know WEC is very cognizant of having high electric rates and being concerned that will.
Thank you.
Yeah. But in terms of an exact rate impact, I don't think we have that.
Is there any generalization around who's got higher and lower rate? I mean, is it relate back to utility scale? Like the smaller that's a number, the higher cost per kilowatt is not necessarily.
Not necessarily. I don't think we actually have some of the lowest residential rates in aggregate. But even within our members' rates range probably from 8 cents to about 22 cents among our 11 members. So it's a variety of factors. One of those factors is whether you have a hydro resource that's in your community.
And just to make sure I understand what you were saying, so is your concern around meeting energy goals that the more expensive electricity gets, the less attractive it is for people to electrify existing fossil fuel loads?
Yeah, okay. Exactly.
So you keep focusing on net metering, and if we depend largely on net metering to meet these goals, isn't that some of our most expensive energy, and doesn't that affect rates pretty dramatically as well if that's where we're developing?
Yes, I would agree with that. Much of our tier two deployment so far has been net metering. This bill doesn't explicitly expand, it's silent on net metering, but we do have a concern that raising tier two to 20% would encourage more net metering, and it is the most expensive way to meet tier two.
That's what I was thinking.
Mayor King, interrupt me if I'm in error, please. We're looking at some amendments in finance that would take into account any new, actually this being drafted now, any new renewables to take into account places that are already constricted, and to say that they should not be taking big chunks of new renewables until the other areas where there's room, there's a location to be filled, and that the larger net metering activities might also be curtailed. We had some testimony that the smaller net metering were added a degree of nimbleness and flexibility that was one could accommodate, but the big ones were more challenging to areas, particularly where there was constrained electricity. So there will be some changes in the finance bill comes here, and those were Luke is drafting some amendments that we'll be discussing this afternoon or tomorrow. In an effort to address that. We haven't heard from WEC recently in our testimony. A couple calls into Ms. Richards. The chair was asking about what makes it difficult for utilities, and the two numbers that always seem to come back to me is how many customers you have per mile. That separates utilities into their efficiencies, and what percentage of your customers are homeowners and versus commercial industrial, because you can coerce commercial and industrial to use electricity at different times of day that doesn't it uses base power that might otherwise be lost. Mm-hmm. And you represent a wide swath of mm-hmm. of municipalities, each of which has probably pretty separate houses per mile and customers, industrial versus homeowners. So I think that's what finance is looking at right now. Senator King, Andrew, tell me where I'm on base.
And I think you've nailed kind of the two issues. There are kind of two cost drivers, I think, as we look at Tier 2 and increasing Tier 2. And one is the grid-related costs, the infrastructure of what does it take to accommodate this electricity. I mean, I think to Velko's testimony, we would literally be exporting solar electricity during a lot of hours of the year. So the grid constraint and the grid costs are one bucket of costs, and then the power supply costs are kind of the separate ones. How much more expensive is it to buy solar or wind or something else than basic power?
What your people have to pay for the rather high cost of bringing.
I don't think you're supposed to call them your people.
And this would
be correct.
The utilities so ably represent here at the table today. The munis. Bringing is expected to expire in 2 years under current law, and that would reduce the amount of money that utilities are paying for the rather high cost for currently in the Rite Aid, which was $5 million a year, and $50 million over 10 years, unless Massachusetts wind comes on, and then there would be $54 million over 10 years. Mm-hmm. Those are generally agreed upon numbers. How does that affect your munis?
I mean, I think the rate we're paying for Rygate right now is about 10 cents a kilowatt hour, and that would include the renewability of that plant. So is it above market, the $5 million you referenced? Absolutely. It's more expensive than market power. It is a renewable in-state resource. So we're neutral on the Rygate bill, the extension of the contract. It is paying slightly more for an in-state resource, and if the state's policy is that we want to have some of our own generation, you know, supplied within state resources, we're not in opposition to that, provided that the rate is reasonable, which I think the current rate is reasonable. So, and I'd be happy to testify on the Rygate bill, but
my question is, if Rygate were to terminate, and then new renewables would come on, would they be less than?
No, new renewables would be more expensive to develop than the Rygate. Yes. Yes, you can, new biomass is probably not viable. So this is kind of similar to our hydro question that, you know, that BEPSA is proposing here. How much do you invest in keeping what you have operating versus closing down a 20 megawatt plant and then trying to replace that with a new resource that will be more expensive to build and site and permit? I'm sorry, I know I'm...
that was good. That was helpful. Yeah.
Questions, and some of them are in this bill, and other are coming to this bill.
The three bumper car sectors.
Yeah.
I know. Well, and I do think it's important to bring these kind of competing discussions or complementary discussions together.
Yeah.
So my next three slides are pictures, so hopefully we can go through those fairly quickly. This is just to try and illustrate the interplay between the power supply that you purchase. This is where we get our electricity for our 11 municipal members. These are the different sources of purchase. And so you'll see a great deal of diversity there. System mix is what we're buying from ISO New England. The rest of these are either contracts. Hydro would include Hydro Quebec as well as internal hydro. And then the next chart shows our renewability in compliance.
Question on those
yes.
purchases. Mm-hmm. Do you buy as a block, as opposed to Barton Electric and going out and doing something?
Yeah, BEPSA does the power supply in aggregate. It is a little bit more complicated than that, but yes, we are able to, at least to the extent that we have economies of scale from our 11 members, we're able to do that. And then each member decides individually on each contract whether they want to participate or not. So for renewability, that's demonstrated, as you'll see here, almost exclusively through hydropower. That wood, I didn't check that, maybe Rygate, that would be constituting wood. Solar would be mostly net metering and some standard offer. And that's looking to comply with Tier 2 in this picture here. and tier one, obviously, the overall renewability. So this just shows that there is a great deal of diversity in our power supply, and when it comes to demonstrating renewability, we are selling high-value RECs and purchasing the lower-cost RECs in the interest of keeping rates down for our members' customers.
So you're 37% non-renewable. Where does that come from?
The non-renewable.
Yeah.
So that's if you go back one more slide, sorry. The nuclear, the Seabrook, is a fairly large component of that. That's a 5-year contract, so that's not a long-term contract, and we're looking at what options will fill that gap when that expires. But a big chunk of that is nuclear, which is carbon-free and non-renewable.
When does that contract end?
I think 2022.
Soon.
Okay. Yeah, they're actively looking at most likely wind and hydro to replace that chunk that would come from out of state. Thank you. And then obviously some is fossil fuel, what we purchase on the market. This just shows net metering deployment. This is just showing that we are seeing aggressive solar deployment in Vermont. The net metering program has been largely successful in getting solar developed here, and there's breakdown with all of our individual utility members, and that's largely a result of the attractive compensation that's been paid under that program. In addition, we've touched on there are more cost-effective ways to deploy solar than net metering. These are projects that VEPSA is pursuing with a PPA with a developer. Those are staff from Encore Renewable Energy there, cutting the ribbon up in Morrisville. And these solar projects are, well, that's one that came online, but these are all scheduled to come online this year. And this is a direct result of the Renewable Energy Standard Tier 2. This is, we're building projects to satisfy our Tier 2 need.
Is when you look at the munis that you represent, is what they have in common generally a bigger bite of hydro than the rest of other places? What distinguishes the group from the rest of the renewable power purchasers?
I can't say what distinguishes us. About half of our members, and I'm going to get into hydro right now, about half of our members own their own hydro resources, but we have members that don't own hydroelectric.
You go ahead and listen.
Okay, sure. So overall, in aggregate, VEPSA's members own enough hydropower to generate electricity for over 8,000 homes. It's just a graphic there. And the list of the members that do own hydro facilities appears here. The benefits are this is locally sited, it's renewable, it's fairly low cost, and it's complementary to solar generation. That's a point I had meant to make earlier on, that as we have this Tier 2 conversation, we think resource diversity is really important. Having all of our local resources be solar doesn't make sense from a power supply portfolio. Hydro and solar have different load shapes. They provide electricity at different times of the year and times of day, and that's a good thing from a power supply planning perspective in terms of minimizing risk. And the challenges we've seen in recent years around our hydro is, as I alluded to earlier in testimony, going through relicensing efforts has typically reduced output 30% to 40%, and that's in adherence to the new updated water quality standards. So plants need to get relicensed, I believe, every 40 years. So there has been a lot of change in how the state implements water quality over that time. And so when a plant goes in to be relicensed, they're taking a pretty big hit on their output. And we've had the Morrisville units and Lindenville have gone through relicensing, and the remaining four, with the exception of Barton, are coming right up on their relicensing and expecting to see reductions in their output. And the concern there is that they have an existing resource that's located in state. It's sending value directly to the community.
No new environmental impacts.
There's no impact, exactly. There's no grid impact because those have been absorbed, and it's making it harder to meet our renewable energy goals to have this reduction in output.
The ANR implements on behalf of the federal government a review, I forget what it's called, like a 401.
401C, that's exactly right. ANR implements, there's a portion of the water, Clean Water Act that the states are responsible for interpreting and implementing, and there's differences in how different states implement that federal provision. But ANR's interpretation is that they cannot look at economics or renewability of the generation in issuing those water quality certificates. They are able to look at recreation and aquatic life, but not overall climate or energy considerations.
So is it less impounding, more bypass? What is it that they're requiring?
Yep, I think, and I'm not a hydro expert, but with that caveat, they want the plants to operate as close to run of river as mm-hmm. possible. So less impounding. Only one of these, the H.K. Sanders in Morrisville, is the only one that is a reservoir. And they want more bypass constantly around the clock in all hours.
Oh,
more water flowing over the dam.
In all hours.
You
can't select.
Right.
It's more difficult to select peak use hours.
Yes. It's more difficult, yes. So H.K. Sanders in particular has had a very hard time, and I don't know how familiar folks are with the Morrisville relicensing, but they're finding it's not even economic to operate that dam under the reduced flow, and are in a little bit of a conundrum about whether to pull out the dam, which would drain the reservoir.
Which seems absurd when we have dams producing low cost, base load energy, and it's happening all over the state. We are choosing one environmental benefit over another. And you know, I remember talking about this with Senator Westman when we were going through the Morrisville thing, and he was saying they're going to make it so this we can't even run this great resource that's been there. Any idea? It's been a long, that thing's been producing power for a long, long time.
The early 1900s, most of these are 100.
I understand it.
Yeah.
And so if we shut this thing down, what do? Do we blow the top off another mountain and put up a bunch of windmills? Do we fill some more farm fields with solar panels? And so what are we lending off? What exactly?
The reason for shutting it down again was?
They're not letting them use enough water to make it economically feasible.
And is that for all three of the dams in that complex?
No, those are separate hydro units. And H.K. Sanders, all three went through relicensing. H.K. Sanders is the one at Green River Reservoir that's having the most difficulty. It's very small, and most of the value of that plant did come from the fact that it was a reservoir, and they could essentially release the water to do peak reduction. That value has basically been erased. So just generating the energy is providing minimal value.
Okay.
If you have what these utilities charge for the electricity they sell, would they be in concert with a percentage of their own generation? Would they lower down on us somewhere lines?
No, and I think that just gets to there are so many variables that impact utility rates. One of them you've alluded to, which is customers per mile and your mix of customers, two of them. Swanton has probably the lowest rate. Swanton, of our members, Barton has the highest rates. So there are other, I think, factors that go into.
Even though Barton's the second.
It's the second largest percent of its power supply coming from hydro.
Is there shortcoming customers per mile?
Their shortcoming's been poor management for a lot of years, I think. The customers per mile impacts it, but Barton, that whole municipality, has had some questionable management that has cost them a lot of money over the years, and that's part of the problem, I think a big part.
And I'm speculating, I think Barton does not have a lot of commercial and industrial customers.
No, they
as
don't
well, to offset. Cost. So just it's a little bit more complicated than to say those with hydros have lower rates, although it certainly helps keep rates low in some cases.
Well, if one of these companies just said we quit, they get taken over by Green Mountain Power or directed to be taken over by a local large utility, would the customers in those districts see increases or decreases?
Some would see increases and some would see decreases. I mean, again, some of our members have much lower rates than the other utilities in the state that are not public power utilities, and some have slightly higher. Barton happens to have slightly higher rates, but Barton's rates are in line with Vermont Electric Co-op's rates, being kind of the neighboring utilities in that area.
Well,
so they wouldn't see it.
Yes, you know, say that's not
a lot to brag about. It's better than Washington Electric.
Yeah, I will try to be quick in wrapping up.
I'd like to make one more quick, quick thing. This whole conversation here is very interesting to me because we're talking about trying to go to more renewable. We know that we need some kind of storage or some kind of baseload, yet at the same time, our own ANR is making these small hydros less efficient and less able to store power. Some of these things can act as a battery, and we're saying, no, you can't act as a battery anymore. Instead, we're going to buy lots of Tesla batteries and hang them up on people's walls, which, you know, the expense and the energy to create a battery, and then what do we do at end of life with batteries? It just seems counter to what we're trying to do as a state.
Remind me again, ANR is doing this in interest of habitat, something?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay, thank you.
Run a river.
Right.
So, right, and the critters in the river.
Yep.
But what this brings to the table is that she represents many different places than the rest of the witnesses tend to represent one place. So this is, I guess my questions are, you've got a lot of different control groups in this one, but hey, trying to see what, how they compare to one another, right? Where is the rest of the folks that tend to have one point of view and push more aggressively than fits their utility.
Moving on to our proposal around hydro, and I did put out an amendment or circulate an amendment. And to be explicitly clear, we're not looking to change ANR's approach to relicensing hydros. What VEPSA's intent is to find what we consider a win-win, a hybrid solution that allows the dams to keep operating and be economic and deliver value to the communities, even given reduced output. And so that's, our overall request is to make these locally owned hydro units tier two eligible as a way to bring value and to avoid having those ratepayers then have to procure more renewable electricity from new expensive resources. So this is our recommendation. Again, this is to the extent that the state wants to place a value on state renewable, which VEPSA does feel is important and there is benefit to that. It should acknowledge existing in-state generation as well. For these units in particular, the RECs would be kept in-state. These would be used towards Tier 2 compliance in-state. So as we know, even though we have renewable energy generation in the state, a lot of those benefits are flowing outside of Vermont. And again, some of these hydro units were, they're centerpieces to the community. They're the reason that a lot of these utilities emerged. They were the, Enosburg Falls, the dam is right in town and was the basis for the actual
basis for the development of the whole community in some cases.
Yes, and so there's a great deal of, pride and value that the communities place on these assets.
Sure. Recall the Tier 2 RECs, that they only went to new generation. Is that generally true? If you weren't allowing them on existing generation?
Yep, the Tier 2 right now, the requirements are under 5 megawatts and came online after July 1st, 2015. And I think since the RES statute was implemented, our experience has shown we weren't aware that these reductions in output were going to be coming. So I think that's one thing that we didn't understand. I think when the RES was initially proposed, it was assumed that all in-state generators would continue to generate at their historic levels.
So they're adjusting to a changing regulatory environment. That makes sense. It's a creative idea. We'll have to work our way through it.
Sure. So we just see this as kind of bringing those conflicting or competing state policies into better alignment, not saying that habitat is not important and that ANR isn't furthering an important goal, but this would, our energy goals are also in complement, are also important. And adding this value, bringing this additional value, one, avoids the need to purchase other replacement sources, renewable sources, and also would give the hydro owners more certainty around making investments in their plants to improve the productivity. so they'd have some capital freed up to potentially operate more efficiently, get better output even with the reduced flow.
And one other point about the whole run-a-river reduced flow argument, whatever wildlife is in that river has been, in some cases, dealing with that increased, decreased flow for their entire existence for the last 100 years. So the environment, whatever it is, I'm sure has made the evolutionary changes necessary.
Yeah. We've already selected.
We've already selected.
A rapid Darwin. Hmm. Okay.
So that's, I think that's pretty much end of my testimony. I mean, we did have some recommendations on the HQ limit. Again, the S267 as drafted has a cap on the amount of HQ that can be used for Tier 1 compliance. We're not advocating for a cap, but to the extent the legislature decides one is appropriate, we would just ask that it be the same across all utilities.
Okay.
And, you know, setting broad policy, essentially, as I mentioned, the utilities are asking for a degree of flexibility if we contemplate increasing our renewable requirements. And that flexibility has come in different flavors from different utilities. But for VEPSA in particular, we're looking at flexibility to use what we already have. So I've introduced that as an amendment to the bill, and we think that's valuable. That's a valuable change now because we are embarking on relicensing kind of in the short term.
So I have a quick question on cost related to siting. So when we did Act 177, the whole idea of creating some sort of regional, local control, financial governance, et cetera, and then working on NEWA 2.0, part of it was to try to adjust the siting and the price to get generation, you know, bring right to the table from the get-go, an engineering analysis mm-hmm. that would drive projects to be well-sited, not just aesthetically, but in terms of load. Is the current regulatory environment delivering projects that are well-sited in terms of generation next to load, and then sort of a subversion of that question, and next to sufficient transmission and distribution infrastructure to efficiently distribute that power?
Yeah, I would say not. I think that the Act 174 provisions that you alluded to gave the communities a bigger role in which sites were desirable for development, which is separate and distinct from whether the grid can handle the added generation there, and is separate and distinct further from whether generation is adjacent to load. So I do know that there are provisions within net metering that I think make do give a little bit more compensation if you have 50% of the off-takers are adjacent to the project. But in terms of my understanding is that there's not an incorporation of grid conditions in either net metering or standard offer or kind of the regulatory scheme more broadly, and that those determinations are still being made on a case-by-case basis. We've seen the PUC deny CPGs for projects in the SHEI, but that's, in my mind, a reactive approach rather than proactive.
Well, so, you know, that feels to me like we talked about that blend, trying to aim for that kind of engineering assessment up front, so we should have projects proposed that would make sense. Mm-hmm. And work through there. How about interconnect costs? Do they end up being, is that really sort of the chief mechanism for filtering? Like, the interconnect costs go high enough because it's not a good location, but that flushes. So those projects don't even come to the PUC, or is that not enough of a deterrent to having sort of poorly sited projects from a load perspective proposed?
Sure. I think the fear is, I'm trying to think of the clearest way to say this. Yes, the interconnect costs can be a gatekeeper and a barrier to developing a project. If a developer wants to connect and we say it's going to cost, you know, the price tag will be big, they may look for another site. The implications of doubling Tier 2, that policy, if the utility is on the hook to procure more in-state resources, even with a big price tag, the utilities may be forced to say, yes, I will buy your output at this high rate. Because obviously interconnect costs just get embedded into the rate, right? People say the developers pay, but ultimately that does get passed on to the consumer.
Great. Well, thank you. I mean, I just wanted to check, because if we're talking about any kind of expansion of an obligation, then I think
we better have sorted out the engineering sort of feedback part of how we plan.
Well, we're not really planning right now, and we really haven't. We've let the developers
Why is he proposing? So if tier two doubles, and there's going to be more generation based to satisfy that, then we're creating pressure for more projects or whatever we want to call it. But
we still don't have an efficient way to, other than the PUC saying no, to stop projects that are where projects don't necessarily be, and that's
right. And so that's why I wanted to check. So right now, I'm here. Welcome. It's reactive. It's not providing guidance ahead of time. Enough.
Yeah. Yeah, my understanding is that conversation's come up a little bit in the finance committee, and they're using the terminology location versus siting, siting being the aesthetic community concerns, and location being where does the grid handle it.
And, mm-hmm. and where does the grid need it?
Yeah.
That's, to me, that's the important part. And the part of our downfall is that we haven't given the department or anybody else the charge to say, build a map, show us where we need it, and that's where we are going to let developers do
it. I think we did 1.4 in 2017. So it's now we're gaining enough experience to see what's working or not working, and maybe it's time for further change. So thanks so much.
Yeah. Thank
very
you.
Helpful.
Appreciate it.
With Mr. Crowley, sorry to run long, but there are a lot of questions on this. Would you like to reschedule, or is 15 minutes enough time for your presentation?
Well, 15 minutes would be enough time for me. I'm not sure it'd be enough time for you guys.
You've noticed that would work.
Which would I would.
So let's
perhaps reschedule. I could do this now, or I could reschedule.
So we can have a thoughtful conversation.
It feels like a little bit of a speech.
I told her to be 10 minutes late
because you asked. Wow. Okay. So
I'm fine with this right now.
Let's go ahead. We'll take the, we'll reschedule the Proposition 9 work.
Well, okay, so I have some copies here, but I'm probably not going to go directly off of this. Anyway, something, okay. Okay, so I'm Steve Crowley. I'm the energy chair for the Vermont chapter of the Sierra Club. We're a group that operates in the state as a chapter. We're also a nationwide organization with something like several million members around the country. We have about, I think it's about 3,500 members in state. And we've been working on energy matters for several decades and other issues as well. Nationally, we had more of a focus on, say, wildlife and forests and wilderness until about 15 years ago, when we made energy and climate issues our top national priority. And I had the opportunity to work with National Sierra Club to make that change happen, and then I chaired their campaign for several years and had a chance to work with states all over the country on different policy matters. So it's been interesting to watch Vermont sort of sometimes be a leader and sometimes not so much be a leader. I think it wouldn't be fair to say in too many areas that we're leading on any of this right now. And it would be great to see Vermont pick that up again. So what I'd like to focus on here with regard to S-267 is primarily the question about the Tier 1 concept, and I want to raise some questions about whether that's generally met by renewable resources at all or not. But let me start with addressing.
Sorry, just to let you know, so we're taking the top 9 off the table. We have a whole half hour, so.
Oh, okay.
Proceed in confidence.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Well, that's helpful. So with regard to Tier 2, we strongly support expanding Tier 2 to 20%. We would suggest going further than that. It's our view that it might be narrowly defined right now and could be expanded in terms of what we consider Tier 2, the higher quality renewable energy, probably in several different ways, expanding to include more local, smaller hydro is one interesting thing to think about. Community solar, there's a handful of different things that could happen around Vermont with smaller scale distributed generation that make a lot of sense.
Can I ask a quick question? So we've heard that in finance and here that this is not going to necessarily reduce our greenhouse gas impact. So can you tell me how you sort of square that with your thinking around some of your priorities?
Well, we think that Tier 2 does and should. When we talk, I mean, let's have to be a little careful here because renewability and carbon neutrality are not the same thing.
Right, right.
So that's important to keep in mind. And it's, I think it's an important question to ask, you know, what's our priority? Often they line up really well, but they don't always line up really well. So I think that's part of the question, but I think it's the whole question of whether it's more or less renewable and carbon neutral are central to our thinking about this. We certainly think that the Tier 2 resources are a huge economic development engine. And we have seen that sector of the economy grow rapidly in Vermont and then decline as our local generation met various standards or caps.
Can I check in on that? So when you say decline, based on what data?
I'm thinking primarily of jobs in the clean energy sector, which were a few years ago were up to, 17,000? I don't have the numbers on top of my head, but they have declined by a couple of thousand in that time.
We just got data from the Department of Public Service that does annual report.
I have heard it from Renewable Energy Vermont.
Okay. We should probably share that data. Because it shows that there was, in general, they do absolute head counts, and then they also do a percentage of whether you're part-time or full-time. Mm-hmm. They sort of weighted count.
Okay.
And we're back in job growth and total numbers, and a higher percentage of those people are working a higher percentage of their total job in clean energy. But they changed the metric on how they say who's in. And so it could be someone's parsing that piece differently. So,
but also, we have to acknowledge the point that we can't continue to pay three times as much for power as worth and cost shift that onto people who are not net metering. And the point is, those jobs were growing exponentially when we were giving an excessive incentive.
I think there's truth to that, yeah. I think your point is it adds to my point that the kinds of incentives we offer translate directly into development of that sector.
Right, but we should be developing where we have the most impact in net metering. Has had a big impact, but it's the most costly way to produce power. So there are better ways to produce it, but the net metering does provide many jobs, and there's the balance. If we focus on the very high cost energy that produces more jobs because it's less efficient to build those systems, are we really making progress? And I say we're not, because that cost is getting passed on to a lot of people who can't afford their power bills today.
Well, I I think that's those are important points. What I would suggest is setting targets for how much carbon-free power we need to generate in state or nearby. And if our policies are supporting that development path, then our policies are right on target. If we're falling off of that development path, then our policies need to be more generous. If we're exceeding that, let's pull back. But let's set the targets to where they need to be based on science, based on what we know about, primarily my thinking is in terms of climate change and the need to get to zero, carbon neutrality by 2050. I think that the science is really clear about that. The only place where it's fuzzy is that might be way too slow, but that's what our state goal is right now. And so if we're on track with that and our renewable energy development puts us on track with that, then we're offering the right kinds of incentives. If we're falling off of that path, then we need to increase incentives. That's my
question. I've heard from other folks, which was, if we move to 100% renewable by 2030, every utility that's provided testimony has supported, then what's the, someone might say, okay, if we've created that obligation for them, why not have them solve that puzzle as economically as possible? Why specify in-state versus out-of-state?
Well, let me address that by, I have a few comments about Tier 1 generally that I think will address that. I'm not a big stickler for state boundaries, even international boundaries, but there are real world considerations that come in related to those things. Particularly control and verifiability, and we know what we're getting, and do these projects meet standards that allow them to be cited? If there was a location in Vermont, would we tolerate this here in our state? So those things all are important factors. But let me address Tier 1 generally. I have great concerns about this because I think the concept is fine, but where we turn out to get our power, which is primarily Hydro-Quebec, something like 50% of our overall power is either direct purchases from Hydro-Quebec, which is, now I'm going back a few years because that's the latest data that I have, but it was about 23% direct purchases and about 24% the RECs, the unbundled renewable energy attributes. So I think it's worth looking at what we're getting, and in this case, I think there are real questions from that source, whether that's renewable power in the first place, and secondly, whether it's carbon neutral or positive. So to address the question of renewability, well, in our statutes, a decade ago, the size cap was lifted. It used to be 200 megawatts. Before that, it was 30 megawatts. Other states say 30 megawatt cap on hydro. Now we don't have any cap on the size of hydro. And that's a little arbitrary. I think there's probably some big projects that are okay, but by and large, the larger projects involve several things that relate to the question of renewability. If you look just at the flowing water, it's fine. It's renewable. It keeps on coming as long as it keeps raining. But if you look at other aspects of the resource, and our law is not narrow in terms of saying just water. It says if you're using a resource faster than its regeneration rate, then it's not renewable. And so, well, what has to be regenerated? In the case of some of the large hydro projects, if you're going in there and cutting hundreds of square miles of forest, well, if you're doing that for the purpose of producing paper or producing wood products of any kind, that's not going to be considered renewable. But we do that for hydro. We wipe out hundreds Hydro-Quebec alone has something like 12,000 square miles of reservoir that used to be forest and peatland. Vermont's share by percent of, you know, terawatt hours is about 100 square miles of Quebec that has been clear of forest. So we close our eyes to that. We don't consider the issue of the fish resource in the rivers, which has been poisoned with methylmercury and is no longer suitable to consume and has caused health problems by people who depend on that resource for food. So there's another strike as far as what's actually a renewable resource.
It's the source of the methylmercury.
The source is the naturally occurring mercury that's in the soils and in the biomass that's part of the soils, and you know, once it becomes in the reservoirs, once it becomes flooded on a regular basis, then that develops a whole food chain of bacteria that do that conversion from an inorganic, pretty inert form of mercury to this methylmercury that then becomes absorbed in the fats and works its way up the food chain. So by the time it gets to the salmon and top of the food chain fish that the folks there eat, it's at such high concentrations that it'll make you sick.
So when you're talking about the environmental impacts, does your group look the same way at the mountaintop wind projects, because they clear cut, they completely change an isolated environment to something different?
Yeah, there's no question about the fact that it changes a ridgetop. But I would say this. I would say that if you're looking at something like the impacts of a wind project, if you think about acres per megawatt, mm-hmm. A wind turbine, you know, a big 3 megawatt wind turbine might take 3 to 5 acres per tower, right? So, so that's about an acre a megawatt. If you look at solar, a field of solar panels we see all over the place, that is more like 20 acres per megawatt. If you look at hydro,
less impact. The solar is definitely different. Less impact.
It's certainly different.
It's both different, I guess, in my humble opinion, less than the other two we're talking.
Well,
about.
That yeah, that. But if so 1 acre, 20 acres, about a half a square mile for a megawatt of hydro. So it's 320 acres for a megawatt of hydro. Not if it's front of the river, not if it's one of the smaller facilities that doesn't have a huge reservoir, mm-hmm. and it depends what the reservoir used to be before it was a reservoir.
Right.
But in terms of, you know, my point would be that there's a real question about whether this particular source, I'm not saying all tier one sources, this particular source that happens to be half of our portfolio, it's really questionable whether that's a renewable resource at all. Even though it's, you know, we allow over 200 megawatts, that's arbitrary, that's in law. But the rest of it, it's a real question to me. So the other aspect of it is carbon neutrality. And when we think about this forest that's up there, that's soaking up carbon dioxide. It's putting, and that's where, you know, it's putting it into the soils. Because of the cooler temperatures up there, it just builds up in the soils and has been for 10,000 years. So there's an enormous carbon sink up there. It's shifting because of the changing climate, but there is an enormous carbon sink. And part of it is the forest, and part of it is peatlands, which are like wetlands here. They're really important carbon sinks, and they have been doing that for a long time. When you clear that and flood that, you lose that carbon sink. You lose that whole potential for carbon sequestration. At the same time, once you flood it, that carbon that was built up in the soils and the biomass starts to decompose at a faster rate than it used to. So now you have emissions, greenhouse gas emissions from the reservoirs, both CO2 and methane. Methane is, as you know, I'm sure you know, is a much more powerful greenhouse gas, 86 times as powerful as carbon dioxide, especially over, you know, if you stretch it out over a long, long time, it decreases. But over this critical next few decades, a huge footprint for every methane emission. So when you add those two factors up and you work it out on a grams of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour, it actually is better than just burning natural gas, but not a lot better.
Is that all this in your testimony?
It is.
Excellent.
Yes.
I guess a couple points. Number one, your carbon neutrality discussion, I like, and I wonder if you've seen my bill, I think it's S201, that would require all Vermonters to be responsible for their own carbon. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen that. I've asked for that.
I have read that, yes.
It's a concept worth exploring. How it's not simple, but what bothers me in this building are the folks who pretend to be worried about climate change, and then when the session's over, they jump on a jet and fly around the world. I think there's a lot of people who say we got to do something about climate change, but they take far too many commercial flights.
Well, I won't address that. That's a separate discussion. But in regard to your forest question, I think it's an important one. I think that people are working hard to figure out how to make that a real and valuable effort statewide. I think one of the things that's super important to consider is that the status quo that we have today is creating an enormous problem for the planet. Mm-hmm. I guess that Australia is the best recent example of that. The IPCC, the International Panel on Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has pointed out that this is one of the differences between the super aggressive reductions, the 1.5 maximum temperature increase pathway, and the 2-degree pathway. The 1.5-degree pathway predicts significant major heat and drought and fire conditions in the southern hemisphere. The 2-degree pathway says that those conditions show up in the northern hemisphere. So what we saw in Australia is coming here.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what the status quo is bringing us. So with regard to forests, it's really important to think not just about the status quo, and forests have been doing this for that, million, forever, right? Mm-hmm. But we have to think about what we can do that's additional. What can we do extra? So if we commit to taking forests out of rotation permanently, then you can start, then at that scale, you can think about the extra growth in the forest that is doing extra sequestration. But to do the normal status quo kind of sequestration that happens all the time is actually not helping. I mean, it's a lot better than, going back to the 1880s and having Vermont be clear-cut completely. But when we think about what we do with our forests, we think about additionality and permanence as far as what we need to accomplish for the carbon cycle.
Permanence, you're saying no cutting trees?
It's complicated.
Well,
it's way more complicated, and there are other people that know more about this than I do. But and I recommend having them here when the time comes. There are different management. It's complicated about management.
Yes.
Good that you sensed that man trap that was being set for you right there and walked around it. So when you're looking at your analysis, do you do assessments on embedded energy and creating infrastructure? I mean, I'm just
For instance, cement has very high energy hydro facilities, I believe.
Well,
you're talking about even creating power lines, all that kind of thing.
Well, the creation of anything from a solar panel to a windmill to a hydro dam, they all have.
It's a complicated question.
The hood and start looking at the embedded energy of the technologies that were.
Right. Yes.
Apparent.
Well, typically, hydro from greenhouse gas from large hydro is an interesting example of that. Typically, you'll see if you look up the numbers on grams per kilowatt hour. It's something on the order of you get like 30 to 40 grams per kilowatt hour is what's listed for large hydro. But that's entirely embedded in the concrete and the construction. And it's generally considered carbon neutral as far as landscape impacts and emission impacts from the reservoirs. Where I come up with numbers from like 100 to 200 when you add in the others, just burning. Really efficient burning of natural gas, methane, is something like 200 in the ideal, not counting fugitive methane. But
including the fracking and extraction.
Correct. Correct. But just burner tip.
Yeah,
depending how efficient the plant is. So let me make sure I'm not missing important things that I wanted to cover here. So one other thing I would like to address. I guess is the cost question. That's not in my testimony, but I've been doing some checking on this with the department. It's hard to figure out how much we are spending, and I'm just thinking about. Well, actually, I should back up because I'd like to address the question of the unbundled renewable energy credits, unbundled RECs, which cover about half of that renewable energy that we count from Hydro-Québec. We buy just the RECs. The cap on that is like a penny a kilowatt hour, but I don't think we ever pay that much. Our utilities don't pay that much. My sense, talking to the department, is that it's something like a tenth of a penny per kilowatt hour to a half a cent per kilowatt hour. It turns out that we are purchasing about a quarter of our power, 6 terawatt hour total power supply for the state. A quarter of that is covered by these unbundled RECs. So it turns out if you take a sort of a low estimate of cost for that, say a quarter of a penny per kilowatt hour, $25 per megawatt, then it turns out to be something like $3 million a year that we are spending on these unbundled RECs, which to me don't really do much of anything. Hydro-Québec has a sea of something like 179 terawatt hours worth of power that they produce from their dams, of which we purchase about 1.5 as renewable energy credits alone. So when we do that, we aren't, it's not really renewable. It's not doing anything for our carbon budget. And it doesn't affect carbon, Hydro-Québec's additional growth of renewables in any way. So to me, it seems like we are purchasing these RECs that are not doing a single thing. They aren't helping, they aren't hurting, they're just this, it's paperwork. So we are spending about $3 million a year for this paperwork that really just, it works for our accounting and it works for, within our legal system right now of accounting for renewability, but it's really not helping in any way, shape, or form. So there's $3 million now. If we,
that's
stopped there. 12 seconds, in a way.
Okay. Well, I would love to come back and finish this because I think it's an important aspect of what I'd like to say. And but I'll just finish by saying that we support the 33% cap. As we expand to 100% renewables. We'd like to see it drop. We'd prefer to cap it at the current purchases of Hydro-Quebec Power, which is about 220 megawatts. So rather than have the amount that we purchase from Hydro-Quebec increase as we electrify everything, we'd rather stick to the amount that we purchase now.
Thank you very much.